Y'all, it's your girl Erica Badon,
and I'm Carlton Banks,
and this is What You Know About That.
That's right, where we listen to classic hip-hop and R&B albums from the past that we enjoy in the present and we will continue to enjoy in the future.
Boom, that's right. And you know what, we actually are changing it up a little bit this week. You know, our intro normally says hip-hop and R&B,
but today we're doing a little switch up.
We're definitely
a little mixing the action, because today we're going to be covering an icon and his debut album, which actually sold a million, which was the first gospel album to sell a million units.
Ooh,
Kirk Franklin and Kirk Franklin and the Family.
Okay. I didn't know that. The first gospel
the
album?
The very first one.
Wow. I didn't know that, literally. Yeah, so just getting started, you know, I think maybe in the past episodes, you know, I've always mentioned, you know, the type of music that really resonates with me is R&B and gospel, you know, just music that, you know, hits you here, you know what mm-hmm. I mean? Slows it down for you a bit and hits you right here. So Kirk Franklin, he was like our childhood. If you grew up in church, even if you didn't grow up in church, right?
Right.
His music was still modern enough for you to, you know what I mean?
Because Kirk Franklin, he had that swag. He swagged out the church. I think it really, he brought the mainstream to the black church. I feel like he was one of those people who really put, like, really made that crossover.
Yeah.
Eventually in time.
I think I feel like
he's a genius.
I would definitely give him the genius title, and just gifted and talented. But as a 90s kid, you knew a Kirk Franklin song, even if you didn't know that it was by Kirk Franklin that mm-hmm. wrote it. You know what I mean?
Exactly.
Like I was telling one of my friends that we were reviewing the Kirk Franklin album. He was like, "Yeah, well, I only know one song, which is Stomp." I'm like, "I'm pretty sure you know more than one song by Kirk Franklin." I was like, "Yeah, like Melodies from Heaven." He was like, "Yeah, they want to go rain." I'm like, "Yeah, like come on, nigga, like you know."
Yeah, like.
Bops after bops, you know what I mean? So I was looking forward to reviewing this because, you know, Kirk been the man since you know
this album right here.
Yeah, so we're gonna get into, like, you know, we always do a little background, what was going
background.
On in the culture, you know. I'm excited. Let's just get into it. Let's go.
So, not a lot of people know about Kirk Franklin's upbringing coming up, but he had a very strict religious upbringing. Rebelled a lot in his teenage years. He rebelled a lot in his teenage years, which he has a book or something out. And he goes over all the things that he went to. Like, he was supposed to go to his grandmother arranged for him to audition with a professional youth conservatory. But he was accepted, but he didn't get to go in because of his girlfriend was pregnant and he got bad behavior. So then he studied music, and he studied music, and he still was living wild and reckless. And like then one of his friends died, and that's when he fully decided to get serious. So he returned to the church and actually directed his choir. One of his compositions actually got the attention of Milton Bingham,
Okay.
of the musical director of the Georgia Mass Choir.
Georgia Mass, okay.
And he asked him to lead. He asked him to lead one of the recordings of one of his songs that he composed. And I think that was in 1990. And in 1992, Kirk Franklin came up with his own 17 voice choir, which we now know as the Family. Family is has a lot of impressive names. Both Tamela and David Mann were on this choir, and they've gone on to mainstream and do very well themselves.
Plays, you
Yes.
feel me? I think Tamara got a Grammy, I think.
Tamela got a
You
Grammy.
know,
David Mann is a very successful
TV
comedian.
shows,
Oh yeah.
yeah, thanks.
And And which the great thing about the family is they were all neighborhood friends.
Oh, okay.
They were all neighborhood friends
That's
and
okay.
associates. So the head of the la head of the label that eventually signed to was heard one of his demos, was so impressed, and signed up the whole family. And in 93, the his group, which is net it's now called Kirk Franklin and the Family, released their debut album, where eventually spent 2 years on the gospel charts and also charted on the R&B charts, believe it or
Okay.
not. And it and Nate remained number one on the Billboard charts for 42 weeks. And like I said earlier, it sold first gospel album to sell 1 million copies. So I guess we're gonna get into the musicality of this thing and how, yeah, just how special this gospel album
I
is.
got something to say.
Well,
Just
yes.
about before we get into the musicality of it. You know, it's interesting. Like a million albums, of course, is still platinum. But I'm sitting here thinking about all the other albums that we've reviewed. You know, a lot of them have gone on to sell,
Yeah,
multi-million, 3 million, 8 million. You know what I mean?
they've done numbers, but
So it's interesting to as we're sitting here getting ready to dissect a gospel album, just to see like just the difference in like the commercial value of it. You know what I mean? It's not as of course widespread because it is a specific target audience with a specific message. So I just want that to kind of be like in the back of our minds and your minds, like as we're like going through like the tracks and going through the reviewing of the reviewing of the actual like songs. Like gospel music has a gospel music is the purpose of it is to express your gratitude, your
Love for
thankfulness. You
Jesus.
know what I mean? For Jesus, for God, for your creator, in an expressive, jazzy, emphatic way. You know what I mean? So, just knowing that, I feel like that kind of sets the tone for how we're going to be able to rate this music and this body of work as a whole. So, I just wanted to put that out there. So, yeah. But yeah, I think so what the album consisted of 10 songs, and then some of them were pretty, most of them were pretty like lengthy. It was 10 songs and maybe about 55, 56 minutes or whatever. So that's about 5 minutes per song. which is kind of average for a gospel song, but long for any other, you know, any other song. But, you know, a lot of what, a lot of gospel music is a lot of refrain. You feel me? You're repeating the chorus over and over again. Sometimes there's a lot of mic toss, like back and forth.
Back and
you
forth.
Feel what I mean?
Yes.
So that kind of, I guess, explains the, like, the length of, you know, some of the songs or whatever. But yeah, so the album starts off with the Why We Sing. Song I've heard a million times.
You're the reason why I sing.
You know, that's the little demo.
A little bit of it, but I think it's a beautiful song. Especially having, like, you know, His Eyes on the Sparrow, which y'all haven't listened to that. Listen to that. That's actually a really good song, too. And that's probably the only song on that. Well, okay. Not the only. One of the two songs where it's just Kirk Franklin on lead vocals.
When now, we say vocals, we
well, it's just yeah. we joke about Kirk. We joke about Kirk Franklin and, like, now Kirk Franklin. Now, one thing about a gospel album is Kirk Franklin's not actually singing. He's not actually singing on these records. He's actually just directing a choir. And probably you'll hear him say, tell it to him again, church. Tell it to him again. Like, there'll be little ad-libs, and that's where he's, you know, directing.
He did sing on the little Calypso one that we mentioned. He was singing on that one.
Oh, he did that's sing. He stuff. Did. I mean, he did sing on one of them. He did sing on the one closer to the end.
Yeah. So, you know, get his little singing credits in. But what I think is even more impressive is that he wrote all of these songs and did the arrangement for them. Mm-hmm. So even though I know he can play the piano, I'm not sure if he can play like the drums or not or whatever, but. it's gospel music is just different. If you're a gospel artist, generally you have multiple talents.
Right.
And I think that's the beauty of it. Like, even though Kirk isn't like necessarily a singer per se, whatever. I think that it has to set the tone. Like, musically, gospel music stands in a class in and of itself.
Mm-hmm.
When done appropriately or done, you know, with the intent. It's
right.
that because of the musicality, because of the purpose, because of the crescendos to highlight specific
mm-hmm.
parts of the song, you feel me? It's a class in and of itself. And it's in a class where other genres have pulled and picked, you feel what I'm saying, pieces from it.
Right.
Especially R&B.
Especially R&B.
And the blues, like.
R&B, more, like, you see a lot of the blues in it.
I'm just saying here thinking about the gospel repertoire, and I want to say, Kirk Franklin did something special with this one because, well, he was 22 when he recorded it, 23 when it came out.
Mm-hmm.
And you're writing and arranging these
mm-hmm.
songs that are going to last a lifetime.
Exactly.
You know, be the soundtrack to.
Like, you still have, like, you know, your favorite, like, you still go to church and you hear, like, like Crystal said, like, you still hear a Kirk Franklin song,
right,
being covered,
right, and like the Why We Sing,
mm-hmm.
Silver and Gold.
What was the
second one? He's Able.
Yeah, he's able.
That definitely had that 90s, you know,
that,
feel. You feel
oh yeah.
A little bop. You know what? It kind of sounded a little bit, not exactly, or not even like close to, Digging on You with the TLC a little bit, just to kind of groove a little bit, you know.
Yeah. I'm trying to put the two waves together.
Yeah, but just maybe if you know, go back and listen to it, but just it kind of gave me that feel. Maybe that's still ringing in my ears.
I thought more of Creep. A little bit.
You think?
I think Creep. Because Digging On You was like a smooth. It's like, digging the scene, digging on you, digging on me. And then you put He's Able like that. Digging on you, He's Able. But Creep came on like, but now we're trying to compare it to.
I know.
Creep came on a whole lot harder than Digging On You. Digging On You came in smooth. So that's why I compared Creep, because it was like, Creep, He's Able. Then just the wave on both of them, they're both kind of like the same to me.
I feel like with Creep, that the horns in the back
It kind of.
are literally the only thing that you really hear. You know what I mean? So it's hard for me to, but I feel like I don't know. When I was saying Digging On You, I was just saying like the bop of it, not necessarily the melody. Of course, it's two
Okay.
different melodies, but just the bop, the bop, the
Just
bopping
the
tin.
ride of it.
The bopping tin. But it's cool. It's cool that so what I said, while we sing, He's Able, Silver and Gold. Me personally, I've known the like the family melody, just like 7 minutes long. That used to always come on Pandora when I would be driving, and it's so powerful. It's just straight up praise and worship. And Till We Meet Again, you've literally always heard that, you know, at funerals. Sometimes people sing it at benedictions at the end of a church service or whatever. Like, these are just songs that have stayed the course, you know, of time. But I want to concentrate just on those five, you feel me? Because those are the five that we, for the most part, most people like know, whatever. We gotta talk about like the other five
Yeah, we
too.
gotta talk about the other five. Like, you can't count on the other five. Like, the other five are actually pretty good too.
Yeah, they cool. They cool. What you got? You have
Because, I mean, you got.
Just Call on the Lord and Hear Me. That's a cool song. I can hear somebody singing that like for like devotion or something. If y'all still do devotion, if churches still do devotion, I'm
They
not sure.
still. That's more like okay, yeah. Can't really divide religion, but yeah, certain churches still do that.
And I feel like A Letter From My Friend is kind of very one tone. One tone. It's a ballad, so to speak, you know. Slow. He Can Handle It. I think that's the one where he like, go Jesus, go Jesus, go. Okay. Yeah.
Kirk Franklin was. That's where Kirk. I'm trying to tell you, Kirk was in his bag, boy. But Kirk Franklin was in his bag back in the day. You don't know. He bought that. That's that one little out. That's that one song. I feel like if he was trying to sell himself to the younger market at that time, in that year, that's the song you put on.
Which one?
The one you just said.
When
He's
he
like,
get
go
Jesus,
Jesus, go
the
Jesus, go. Like,
you
I
think?
think that's the one.
I think he's able. I think he's able would be the maybe just because of the it had that the sound of that time. You know what I mean? I can't really, to be honest, like I said, real love.
Not
Not
Mary J's real love,
that
but
real love. Real love, He Can Handle It, A Letter From My Friend, Call on the Lord, and I did like Speak to Me. That had like a little calypso type of island type of flair to it. I like that, you feel me? It was cool. But here's the thing. Here's the thing. Kurt did something controversial that a lot of people are still doing today, where they are modernizing the classic message of the gospel. But and he got a lot of pullback and a lot of pushback
He
from ch
did.
like cr Christians and churches and
He did.
other religious institutions because they said it was blasphemy or. It was too worldly, secular, whatever. Like,
But that's where everything, like, when people don't understand something, they're quick to criticize it. That's just real life, in my opinion.
Yeah, I feel like
And I think religion is probably the most, not to cut you off, but it's harsh. It's very harsh. Yeah, it's harsh. It's very harsh on just like, especially musically wise. Like, I mean, you just gotta I can't like I don't wanna overstep bounds when it comes to like religion. Like, I don't wanna be like just like you're just mean, that type of stuff. But religion, like, how do I bring it?
Why are you thinking about that?
Let me think about it for a second.
What I know about growing up, like going to church, being forced to go to church and things like that, there's this ideology that it's weird. It's weird. I don't subscribe to this belief system, but this is the belief system that was like birthed, that was like present, like, if you do anything, if it don't got Jesus, if it don't got God in it, then it's like of the devil. And I think it's also important to consider the times too of what was going on. Drugs was making, like being very prevalent, HIV, sexual promiscuity, all of those type of things. And I think the church probably looked at Kurt as, because his the sound was similar to R&B and to, things that people could ride to, or things that people, like to bump or dance to. They figured that, okay, well, he's doing the devil's work because this is the same type of music that's destroying our communities. I think that was their perspective, even though I feel like that was a reach. They
That's
was
a
re they
huge
was re they
reach.
was reaching for that, put together.
It's just a bunch of bitterness, in my opinion, just to come at Kirk for that reason and that reason alone.
We watching football at the same time, so excuse us,
Yeah, we
I
gotta
mean,
watch this.
we still in
We're
it.
still here, but I mean,
Oh,
like, honestly, Kirk Franklin is dope. I don't think they really realized how much the youth was actually coming into the church home. I don't think they understood like that whole draw of youth actually coming into church.
right.
So that's why I feel like, the message might have gotten like, I can understand where they're coming from, but you gotta understand, like, Kurt's just trying to like I said earlier, like, he lost his friend. He went through his things, and he's trying to appeal to the younger masses. There's nothing wrong with that.
Yeah, I think just knowing the context of he was in a very nuanced position that a lot of other artists who come out who had their debut were not in. Like, just think about if like we've done Aaliyah and Nas and everybody else.
Brandy and Monica and things like that.
They don't have the societal pressure of an entire social group telling them what's acceptable to them. You feel what I'm saying? They
Right.
kind of they do, like the record labels kind of putting their image together and things like that. But
Right.
it's not an entire, you feel me, like culture of people that you're actually trying to inspire, you're actually trying to help. But then you get that criticism on the back end. So
Right.
it could almost be like discouraging, you feel me? Because a lot of times I feel like the church probably felt like, well, you garnered your gift in church, so we should be able to tell you how to use it. But it's like, yeah, this might have been the place where I was able to, like,
Right.
kind of allow it to grow a little bit, but I got it from God. Y'all didn't give, you know what I mean? Like, they didn't give
Right.
that to him. Like, that was a gift that God gave him. And the like a church was a place where he was able
Right.
to, like, experiment and blah 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 blah. But a lot of times church people feel like they can own you, like they own
Right,
you on some like relative type shit, and it's like,
that's a
excuse me,
like let me ride my wave, sir.
yeah. So I feel like
Pastor Greenhall.
he was in a very unique position and still did a bang up job, with being true to himself, understanding his audience, not only the people in the church, but the people outside of the church who don't know God or who don't know Jesus. The music is just banging. He tried to provide some variety, like we just mentioned, you got a little calypso, you got a little
Yeah, the
you got
Latin
a
kings.
little R&B
Yeah.
with the slower ballads, you got the little bop, little boppington. You got the praise and worship with just lift your hands all over the building. Like it's a good variety of production.
Everything.
Yeah, it's a
Yeah,
good
it's a
like
good, it's
yeah,
everything.
like sonically, it's a good like variety. He had some dope singers leading those songs. And that's really when we're critiquing the album, we're really critiquing the choir. We're not really critiquing him, but we know that he puts, he's the foundational piece for it,
Right, he's it. Yeah.
So yeah, what was your favorite song on the album?
Mine, I like. It's hard to pick one. I like. There's a bunch of little songs that I like, 'cause like not gonna lie, everybody, I was once a choir child, so I actually had to do a couple Kirk Franklin songs in my
Oh,
day.
wow. What
Yeah,
was that?
I was in the choir. So I think one of the ones that actually, you know what was funny? I think one of the ones that I actually ended up not liking back then, I actually pushed Speak to Me to be sung in the choir. Like, I
Really?
actually pushed for that one to be sung into the choir. Like, we actually were singing that one. We actually had to sing that one in church service.
That's definitely a kiddie song.
Is
Speaking to
it?
me like Jesus.
Yeah, I was
Ding,
a
ding, 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 ding.
din, 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 din.
Yeah.
Shout out to Byron Cole and Kirk Franklin, who actually did the lead vocals. But now that I'm older, I don't like it as much. There's not it has nothing to do with the fact that I was like I had to sing it, but Till We Meet Again, I like that one. Like I always mess with my whenever I mess with my girlfriend, I always sing Silver and Gold. I always sing Silver and Gold there, just when I mess with her. And Why We Sing. I think I wanted to sing that one, but the choir director was like, nah, we're not gonna sing that one. It just so happened to be like, our choir day was on Easter Sunday, so yeah, people weren't ready for that wave. They weren't ready. But I like those three. Just the way that they come out smooth. And it's just like a lot of things that came out in the 90s, like that 93. That it came out just it had that smooth little feel. It definitely
That's
had
an
that
interesting point.
it came out smooth. And like I said before, Kirk Franklin is a genius. Just the way he was able to put all that stuff together at 22, 23. Mind you, we're 25, 27, respectively. So just think, someone 2 to 4 years younger than us, literally putting all that together. And then to have that, and I think this is where he brought the streets to his advantage, like being able to bring that swag in and just bring in that, to bring in a new audience. 'Cause I mean, like, if you really think about it, you didn't sell like a million records for no reason. So, but yeah, those are my favorite songs.
I think for me, I like the family worship melody.
I like that one too.
And I like Till We Meet as well. I was it took me a while to get through the whole album for real, because I would like listen to like four or five songs and I had to get out the car, blah blah blah. But I listened to it like today, and I ain't even gonna hold you, like when I got the Till We Meet Again, bro, like that song, so Till We Meet Again, like I said, is normally played like at funerals, or the end of like services or whatever, the end of like a church service. But specifically at funerals. And it had me thinking about my grandparents for real, like that's like a, I feel like that would be like a song that they would like, that's like a message that they would try to get to me on some shit, you know what I mean? It's powerful. I feel like anybody who's like ever lost somebody, who's of the faith, you feel what I'm saying, who believes, that you'll meet them again, you will
You
see them
heard that
again.
song at a funeral. You definitely heard that song at a funeral.
It does something to you. It does something to you when listening, because you can remember a time when they were here, how life was and things like that. It hit me in the heartstrings, and then that's the song that has the mic toss. Like every like there's
Oh yeah,
the people are
you
just
have
repeating the,
like three different leads on that song. And they all come in and they do their own little spiel. And I feel like that's what makes the song so special.
They bring in their own like story, or like they have an own connective point to, they singing like to somebody. You feel what I'm
Exactly.
saying?
It's somebody out there. It's like, I'm not touching you. Oh, you're not reaching this. They're gonna touch you. If they're not reaching you, they're gonna touch you. You don't like this. If we don't touch you, let's do this all as a collective, and we will all get you to cry. Like, that's literally what I got the plan. But that's actually what's so powerful about that song.
And I'll say like the worship melody, it just brings you into a place of just adoration. It literally lifts your head and lifts your focus high above. Like it literally puts your focus and your attention on God the Most High. Some of the lyrics, hallelujah, thank you Jesus, we worship your holy name. Like I said, and the main thing about gospel music is the different keys that it's sung in, the different like volumes that it's sung in to really get it. You're singing the same words, but you're singing it in a different key with a different, like volume to really express, the actual words. That's what makes gospel so beautiful, is that it's just the variety of ways that you can get across your message. You know what I mean? But worship melody just puts me into a place of worship. It really puts me into a place of, as a believer, of God, and Jesus, it puts me into a place of truly thinking about what he's done, who he is, you feel me, how worthy he is, to be praised in this boisterous display, you feel me? Because a lot of people be like, it don't take all of that, you feel me, because blah blah blah. But it's like, if anybody's worthy of this type of display, it's definitely God. You feel me? Like, you feel me? Niggas don't be having no problem getting loud and screaming their lungs out at basketball and football games, and you don't even know them niggas. Look at me. I'm about to preach. Anyway. But no, I'm just saying, like, worship melody does that for me. It just puts me into this place of like, the Lord is definitely worthy to be praised for real, because he is good, so yeah, so again, we mentioned we got a little R&B feel, we got a little like hip hop. Another, when you said you said this came out in 93, it automatically made me think about the Janet album and how that album was so had a lot of variety in it, and this
Definitely.
album had a lot of variety in it, even though it only had 10 songs, you feel me? Again, musically, all genres were going through a transitional phase. So
Right.
you could really experiment with a lot of different sounds. And this album is, again, is proof of that, that 93, 94 was a transitional phase in music as a whole. You could tell with what he's doing with his album. You know, I ain't really hear too much of Tamla Man. You hear more of Tamla Man on the next one, like on the Christmas
Yeah,
one,
that's on the
or
Christmas one.
What You Looking For.
She was on this one. She was on the medley.
Yeah, she was on
She
the
was on the
medley.
medley,
Yeah,
but
that's probably why I like the. That's probably like the, why the melody is like one of my favorites. Because I just she has the power of God in her throat. She has it in her
throat.
throat, like.
In her throat.
You know, and she still sounds that exact same way 26, 27 years later. It's
It's about,
yeah, that's it's amazing. I've heard her sing live. Like I've been to like a Tyler Perry play,
What?
like the farewell one that he did last this year. No, this past year. This
Oh,
past
wait, he
year,
did a fit. Oh,
like a
wow.
Madea farewell, blah blah blah. And what did she sing? She sang because she was in it. And I'm not sure what Brown was in. I don't think Brown was in it, David, but she was in it. She sung God Provides, and you know, they sing live. See, and that makes sense. Like you in a choir, then you go on plays, you sing it every night, so you have to be
It
good.
has to.
You know what I mean? She just sound amazing, like but the like just fills the whole auditorium just with
Right.
God's glory. It's just amazing for real, for real. So
And the other thing that we haven't said, like, this is actually the first live album that's actually been
Oh
done.
yeah, like oh
This
yeah.
is the first and the this is one of the
Yes.
first live albums that we've done. And it was all recorded in one day.
Right.
One day at
Where?
Grace Temple Seventh Day Adventist.
Is that Texas?
Yeah, it's in Fort Worth.
Okay.
Grace Temple Seventh Day Adventist Church in Fort Worth, Texas. Shout out to you guys because you housed the
Yeah,
classic.
that's how all the like most gospel albums were recorded back in the day. Was it was just a concert. It was a gospel concert. You would pay your ticket to get, you know, to whatever. Like, you know, Richard Smallwood.
Familiar with the name.
Yeah, that's how he would do all of his. Whether it was in Detroit, whether it was in Atlanta, whether it was in whatever. Like, that's how most people recorded there. And that's the beauty too. Like, live music is just so much better than synthesized record just in the re studio produced music. I mean, even when you look on the tracks, you know, I will say this though. I will say this. Every other album that we've reviewed, when you go on the personnel portion of that Wikipedia page, you see live instruments. You see live instruments and you see backup vocals. Maybe not on Illmatic. I might be wrong. I might be wrong. But every other album, you see live instruments. And I think that's beautiful. I'm glad that, of course, gospel is well known for its live music because the music just has a pulse, living. You feel what I'm saying? A living, it's meant to move you. So of course, you know, live instruments would be the
It
most
would be a
fitting.
thing, yeah.
Yeah, would be the most
I think
fitting.
artists really started to use, yeah, they definitely started using like live instruments more in the 90s, 'cause I think it's interesting because this is actually totally different because I think I'm not sure, don't at me on this, but I think UGK was coming around that time. And Pimp C was very big about
My man just looped in
over her head, over
my
her
man just
head.
looped in UGK on his gospel job. Go ahead. They both
Yeah,
from Texas. I got
they're
you.
both from Texas.
Mm-hmm.
But like I know Pimp C was very may he rest in peace, but he was very big on live music. Like I seen the documentary and he was very big on live instrumentals. So I mean it's I feel like that's also a Southern thing, 'cause like they wanted to get that actual like sound, 'cause like I know Outkast did it, so like to just have like that dope to have that dope live musicianist, that's to have that dope person who's like good at musically, that's pretty cool.
I think it was just the times, like
I
even
think
just
it's just, yeah, people experimenting a lot too.
yeah, I think even before like even before the 90s, that's what you had. You had the instruments, even when they was doing like the synth pads where they had the little thing and they what's that the little you know what I'm talking about to get the auto tune sound? It was like you put a tube and then you got the little damn keyboard right here. That's what Rogers and the Zap Band used to do, shit like
More
that.
bounce to the ounce.
You know, they were still live, they were still playing that shit. So back then it just gave a better feel to the music when it was when you have live instruments, you know, playing along or accompanying me. But again, we always do just moving along, we're gonna move along. We're not trying to keep y'all here all night. We do the metrics where we grade the album. We normally do lyrics, we do theme execution, we do production, and we do longevity. And vocals. And vocals and vocals. So for me, vocals, I feel like come on, like ain't no choir recording no half-ass like music.
Yeah,
Vocals
you
get a 10.
can.
Vocals get a 10 for me.
We can agree on 10.
Yeah, vocals, so 10 on vocals. Theme execution. Let's see. Okay. It's the debut album of him and this choir. It's titled Kirk Franklin and the Family. They're displaying like who, you know, who they are, what they're about, all their style.
Right. I'll give it a 10.
I would give it a 10 too because like the case that we just
You have the
so,
family, you have pretty much people. It's not just one person getting a shine. It's just like back and forth, back and forth, back and forth.
yeah,
So,
and I feel like they did their due just their due diligence too with coming on a gospel scene, making it sound known, like yeah, we can sing our asses off, but we can also do it to some shit that bounce too. So, yeah, I would say 10. Even though a lot of the family was like older than Kurt, they would a lot of
That's
them, you know what I mean?
true.
They was older,
That's
like,
true. And he's still, and it's still, and he knew them from around the way. He
yeah,
knew them, and they were like his associates, like I said earlier. So, I
yeah.
mean, I would like to know how he knew Tamla and David Mann. Like, I bet you
From church,
he
probably, yeah.
probably. I wonder how he got to meet up with them. That's another story, another day.
I remember this. Maybe they did like a. I'm not sure if they did an unsung, but they did some shit on Kirk Franklin, and they talked about how he started off with the family. Then when the millennium started to come in '99 and the stomp and the revolution, blah blah
Yeah,
blah.
he was in his bag.
And but he ditched the family for a while and he started to work with like people who were younger. It was called GP, God's people. So you get what I'm trying to say? And some of the like the family talked about that like in the little documentary, like we kind of felt like, oh, he kind of left us by the wayside, blah blah blah, because he was on the up and coming, you feel me? So and he was in the shiny suits doing shit like Mace and shit, you feel me, with the fucking ski goggles, you feel me? He was doing that
Not the
shit.
main shit.
He was doing
He
that. Kirk Franklin definitely did this shit.
did that.
But yeah, that was interesting. But I feel like he's always brought it back full circle. He's done his modern tip, but he's also, I don't think he's forgotten his roots. And that's why I feel like he's still, you know, successful today, you know. So yeah, so we did vocals, we did theme, said production.
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 I feel like there's nothing that really went wrong on this album.
Yeah.
There's nothing that went wrong. It's a live album. It's a live album. So it's not like, you can say, you can point out somebody who's like flat. Like
Right.
he believed in his entire choir to go out, make a live album, which was probably back in the old, like Crystal said, this is the only way you could actually make a gospel album.
Right.
So, there's nothing that went wrong for this album for me.
Yeah, I would say too, but would you say like it's a great album?
Oh, I'd say it was a great album. I'd definitely say that. I'd say it's a good,
It's a good album.
it's definitely, it gets a good album, but it's,
Those four songs in the middle, they're forgettable. They're forgettable. To me, the He Can Handle It, the Letter to My Best Friend, the Real Love, they're forgettable, like they're forgettable songs. So just trying to look at it from a whole comp like a whole just a holistic approach. What was the one that we was just on? Production. Oh, production. I mean, production is, I mean, production, I'm gonna give it a 10 on production. I mean, people in church can play. They can play the piano, they can play the bass, they can play the, like, you getting the best of the best when it comes to, like, you know, for the album, I mean, production. But I guess most I'm talking about, like, I guess the album as a whole, the those four songs, they kind of get kind of just thrown in there. You feel me? But the fact of the matter is, he has like four classic songs on here that are still sung to today. So you kind of, they kind of outweigh, not out, they balance each other out, like cancel each other out. But I don't feel like it's like a great album. I don't feel like it gets great. I feel like it was like a good, I'm coming into the gospel thing, doing my own thing, a good introduction.
And you
Maybe.
got people, if people gave him that negative publicity, that only grew his celebrity out. And you gotta think about what happened after, like all the albums that happened after that.
Yeah, I mean,
Like
no.
all the attention he got from that.
I mean, we can, but remember, when we do these albums, we just looking at these
Oh
albums.
yeah, we're
You
just
feel
looking
me?
at
We,
these
you
albums.
know,
Like the legacy of this album.
it put it. Yeah, put them on up. Put them on. Gave them that stamp. It gave them that stamp, but it wasn't a great album. And very few people like have great debut albums, so it's not saying nothing bad.
Yeah, I
I
mean,
mean, that's just my
you
opinion.
have,
That's my opinion.
I
Very few
mean,
people.
yeah.
Yeah, I mean, except Brandy. Just kidding. I'm again.
This is where we are going to end this. I very much thank you all. Like and subscribe. Please give us your thoughts and give us suggestions on albums that you would like for us to cover in the not too very distant future. And next week, I will try to, I will not let Crystal cap on me and my love for
He was
Monica.
about to say Brandy. Did y'all see him? He was about to say
This
Brandy.
is where we listen. I'm not accepting this. So, all right, y'all. This is Carlton Banks. That is
Don't.
Erica. By damn, she's getting on my nerves. And and we will see you all. Remember, like and
Bye.
subscribe.